So I'll just speak about the slide. As I mentioned, Shukadeva Goswami, after his birth, in order to continue the sagely order of life, he heads towards the forest, and Maharshi Veda Vyasa is following him. And on their way, they find a pond wherein the celestial damsels were bathing. And
do you want to share the slide, Mataji? I'm sorry.
Oops, I'm so sorry, Prabhuji. I thought I'm already sharing. Let me do that.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mataji.
No problem, Prabhuji. Okay, Prabhuji, can you see the slide now?
Yes, Mataji, I'm able to see the slide now.
Okay, so this is the this is what we are talking about. Now Shukadeva Goswami, as I mentioned, these celestial damsels who were bathing, they were unperturbed, unconcerned, and they were not worried when Shukadeva Goswami passed by. But then Maharshi Veda Vyasa, who is a realized soul himself, when he came through, when he was almost near the pond, these damsels started covering themselves. So this was this behavior of damsels was very puzzling, and in fact, Maharshi Veda Vyasa was astonished, and he demanded them the reason for it. My son, who is young and who is unclad, while I'm fully clad and I'm a grihastha, why do you see a difference? Like, why are you covering yourself while you did not do it when my son was around? So the celestial damsels, they explain that your son is not an ordinary soul. He is Atmaram and Mukta Jiva, which means it's someone who is dwelling in is not dwelling in the body platform or the mental platform or the intellectual platform, but the soul platform. He does not identify any difference between a man or a woman or an animal or anything for that. For him, everybody is a soul. So he's such pure, he's such such sacred. So that is the reason we did not feel, we absolutely felt we had absolutely no qualms when he entered. But while you being a grihastha, we did not feel the same. So it was a moment of pride for a father, like his son is such realized, such great soul. So yeah. And then Shukadev Goswami walks forward, and he eventually reaches the forest, and he starts his austerities, meditation on the Nirakara Brahman. And while he's meditating, he's totally immersed. But as a father, Maharshi Veda Vyasa, as a father, he's very, very concerned because he had some plans for Shukadev Goswami, and he had some purpose for life which is not being realized. So Maharshi Veda Vyasa had to devise a plan. He comes up with a yukti. So what normally when a toddler is when he's too young, he's not developed the taste for different food items, what mother does is she would not take the entire bowl of food to the kid directly. What she would do is she would move the child and slightly put a morsel of it, and so that it touches the tongue, and then the child would feel, he would develop the taste for it. So in the similar fashion, and if let's say mother gets the entire bowl, the child might just throw it away. He might just kick it away. So in the similar fashion, what Maharshi Veda Vyasa does is he asks two of his disciples from his hermitage to go to Shukadeva Goswami, the place where Shukadeva Goswami was meditating, and he asks them to recite two of the shlokas from the great literature Srimad Bhagavatam. So these disciples had to be very, very clever. They had to sound as if it is obvious. Uh, you know, uh, Shukadev Goswami understanding the their intent behind. So this what they do is they start cutting the wood in the forest as if they are here for some other activity. So while cutting the tree, the disciples start singing this particular shloka from Srimad Bhagavatam. Here it goes. Barha pidam natavaravapu karneyo karnikaram vibrihat vasah kanaka kapisham vaijanti chamalam randrarmeno radhara sudhaya purayan upavinde vrindaranya swapada pramanam pravisha geeta kirti. So this particular shloka I felt very, very beautiful. I mean, I don't know about Shukadev Goswami then, but then I really loved it when I heard the purport of it. So it says that this beautiful Lord Sri Krishna, wearing a peacock feather ornament upon his head, blue karnika flowers on his ears, a yellow garment as brilliant as gold, and the Vaijanti garland, Lord Krishna exhibited his transcendental form as the greatest of dancers as he entered the forest of Vrindavana. Beautifying it with the marks of his footprints, he filled the holes of his flute with the nectar, and the cowherd boys sang his glories. So this shloka, when it was recited, our Shukadev Goswami, who was in deep meditation, as they say, Krishna is all attractive. Even though he was not physically present, his beauty could be felt so greatly that he opened his eyes. He opened his eyes literally and he started searching for, who's that beautiful personality? I really want to witness that. I really want to see him. So that was his desire. Imagine somebody who's a Mukta Jeeva and Atmaram, who is not attracted to anything, is getting attracted to the Lord Krishna. So this shloka had that impact on him. So now disciples had without any ado, what they do is immediately started reciting the second shloka. Aho bakiyam sthanakalakutam jighasya yayadapiya asadvi lebhe gatim dhatri uchitam tatonya kimva dayalam sharanam rajeva. This is again such a beautiful one. I mean, little Krishna is my favorite. I love little Krishna. I mean, even while looking at him now, I cannot take away my eyes from him. So basically, this particular shloka, which means that, alas, Baki, the sister of Bakasura, Putana, had come all the way to kill our little Krishna. In the position of a mother, she was unfaithful. She came as a mother and tried to kill Lord Krishna. But despite all her unfaithfulness, despite her negativity, he's such a purified, he's such a merciful, such a magnanimous Lord that he delivered her. He actually liberated her. So who can be so, so merciful other than Lord Krishna? So now they say that he's not just physically beautiful, but then he is the mightiest and the most merciful God one would find. So listening to this, and the Shukadev Goswami was now completely immersed in the love of Krishna, and he was like, oh my God, then I must get up and talk to the disciples. I'm not able to conceal my excitement. Like, can someone be so good, someone be so exalted? So he immediately approaches the disciples and questions them, please, can you please help me? Where did you get this shlokas from? I would like to hear further. So they tell him, Maharaj, Shukadev Goswami, these are just the teasers. Picture abhi baki hai mere dost. There are 18,000 such shlokas. There are 18,000 such shlokas which would mesmerize you. So you looking at the teaser itself, if you are so engrossed, then imagine your situation when you listen to the entire Srimad Bhagavatam from our guru. So he says, oh my God, really? So I really want to come along with you to meet your guru. So that is how eventually Shukdev Goswami, returns to the hermitage of Vedavyasa. And when he returns to the hermitage, he's like, oh my God, he's my own father, is it? Okay, so he apologizes to his father and he tells him that, Father, I did not consider your request, so please forgive me. But then I would really love to listen to Srimad Bhagavatam. This is such a great literature, and I really want to listen to this. So now Vedavyasa gives him the complete knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam. Well, there are multiple citations of how Srimad Bhagavatam was given from multiple sources to Shukadev Goswami. I have also heard that, it was, we saw that, Lord Shiva, from Lord Shiva, when in his previous incarnation as Shuka the parrot, he heard it from Lord Shiva, then his own father, Maharshi Vedavyasa, and there was a point of time where he heard it from Narada Mahamuni, and it is also said that he heard from Agastya Maharshi and Deval Maharshi. So these are the great souls who helped our Shukadev Goswami to build his love for Srimad Bhagavatam. So, if you see the shloka from Srimad Bhagavatam again, wherein Vedavyasa is trying to glorify the Srimad, when it is heard from the mouth of Shukadev. So I just recite the shloka. Nigama kalpataroor galitam phalam shukamukhadam ritadravasam yutam pibata bhagavatam rasam alayam muhuraho rasika bhuvi bhavuka. So it means, O expert and thoughtful men, relish Srimad Bhagavatam, the mature fruit of desire tree of Vedic literature. It emanated from the lips of Sri Shukadeva Goswami. Therefore, this fruit has become even more tasteful, although its nectar and juice was already there. So basically, it's so beautifully quoted that it is the matured fruit of desire tree of Vedic literature. As you know, any fruit that is ripened on the tree itself, so it is very, very juicy. It is very, very tasty. But then just think, it is bitten by a parrot. Its taste multiplies. In a similar fashion, how beautifully Maharshi Vedavyasa has compared the narration of the Srimad Bhagavatam emanating from the lips of Shukadeva Goswami. So whoever was privileged to hear it from the Shukadeva Goswami were, the blessed souls. So this is about it. And then, we will quickly take the story to a slightly different track here. So, we will definitely fall into track, but we need to understand Parikshit Maharaj's role here before we get into the life of Shukadev Goswami. So, the story of Parikshit Maharaj. Parikshit Maharaj was from the lineage of Pandavas. And as most of you know, I'm just trying to add to what you already know. So Parikshit Maharaj was the grandson of the great warrior Arjuna and son of the Veer Abhimanyu, whose bravery is celebrated till date. And his mother was Uttara. So while he was in his mother's womb, it is said that, Ashwatthama, out of revenge, what he did is he actually, because after the Kurukshetra war, he wanted to demolish the entire Pandava dynasty as well. He wanted to kill everybody from their lineage. He in fact, after the war, killed the five sons of Pandavas while they were asleep in the Shibira. So he did such heinous acts, and which was even not appreciated by Duryodhana. So Parikshit Maharaj was still in the mother's womb, but he used Brahmastra on him. So at that time, who else? Our Lord Krishna saved him from the repercussions of this Brahmastra by absorbing all the heat. So you can obviously think Parikshit Maharaj was such blessed soul that he had the mercy of Lord Krishna even before his birth. Okay, so for Parikshit Maharaj, Lord Krishna was his, obviously he was the greatest disciple of Lord Krishna, and he's, of course, in fact, one of the Mahajans, I'm sure we will cover this in some time later, but he's also one of the Mahajans, as I understand. So Parikshit Maharaj does that's a brief about his childhood. So what happens is, yes, after the Pandavas head for the spiritual worlds, they hand over the entire dynasty to Parikshit Maharaj. Parikshit Maharaj is one of the just rulers. He is the most righteous king. In his kingdom, there was no poverty, there were no social problems, there were no diseases, and there was no calamity as such. So everybody was hale and hearty, healthy, and he had a lot of followers. He would do Vaishnava seva. So that way he was leading a very devotional life. And there was a point in time wherein, you know, as a kings of those times, in those eras, would go for hunting. He also had been to hunting to a jungle or to a forest. So during that time, what happened is he was already 60 by then, and he was aging at the same time. The impact of Kali Yuga could be seen on a lot of people. So at that time, he was very thirsty. Basically, he was very thirsty and extremely hungry. So at a distance, he actually sees a hermitage. And it is hermitage of the sage, it is the hermitage of Shamika Maharishi, who was sitting inside and was in his deep meditation. So Parikshit Maharaj entered. He was extremely weak. So he requested Shamik Maharishi for water and food, but then there was no response from him. He repeated himself politely, but then again there was no response from him. So he thought this is he's being neglected, he's being ill-treated, and in the fit of, he was enraged, and he actually lost his intelligence at that point of time. And he immediately there was a snake which was lying, a dead snake which was lying below. He took his, from the end of his bow, and he garlanded him with that. But Shamik Maharishi was obviously in his deep meditation. He did not realize. Now Parikshit Maharaj left. But his son Sringi, who was playing out with his other Muni Kumaras, when he came to know about this, he was extremely saddened, and what he does is takes the water from the river of Kaushiki, and he curses Parikshit Maharaj, saying that you would die in the next 7 days being bitten by the Takshaka, who is the snake bird. So after 7 days you will have to leave this world. So he does that, and he returns to his hermitage. Now in the hermitage, he observes that there is a dead snake around his father, he's obviously, for anybody, any child, it is not a good scene at all. So he starts crying. He is crying unconsolably now. And when Shamik Maharishi heard the sobbing sounds, he immediately came out of his trance, and he asked him what had happened. So Sringi narrates the entire story to him. So for that, Shamik Maharishi says that, see, I understand what the king did was a shameful act, but what you did as a reaction to this is definitely not something that I would appreciate. It is again a heinous thing, because you are a Muni Kumara. You should have the patience. You should have the audacity to hold on. How can you just? If you also react like a Kshatriya, then what is the difference of we being the Muni Kumaras? So he actually chastises him. But what to do? This is already done. The curse cannot be taken back. So he sends, Shamik Maharishi sends one of his disciples and informs Parikshit Maharaj of the upcoming calamity, but that is threat to his life. So imagine if that had happened to someone of us, we would be so in a panic state. But this great king took it into his stride, and he accepted it as the blessing of Krishna. Can you imagine? He accepted it as blessing of Krishna. And what he did is immediately he handed over the royal dynasty to his son Janmajaya, and he retreated to the forest. And he was with one loincloth. And he was, he was near the Ganges, in the banks of Ganges, and he was taking the name of Lord there. And he was, he had a question in his mind. So looking, when the other rishis and Muni Kumaras or the other Rajarishis came to know about the story of Parikshit Maharaj, they were concerned, and they came all the way to meet him in the banks of Ganga. So when they came, looking at the Parikshit Maharaj, Parikshit Maharaj was brooding and was thinking, he had a question in mind. So just then, by the arrangement of Krishna, I would say, there was a 16-year-old young yogi who had come. He was so absorbed in himself. He was so very completely within himself that he was in a state of trance, basically. And when he came up towards the where all the rishis were sitting, and all the Rajarishis who had come to all the way to meet Parikshit Maharaj before his final day had come. When he comes to the same place, Parikshit Maharaj observes that all these great rishis, including his father Vedavyasa, Narada Muni, and all the great rishis were bowing to him. So looking at this scene, Parikshit Maharaj is taken away. He's blown away. Oh my God, he's such a great soul. All these great rishis are bowing to him. So he addresses him saying that yogi naam api mahaguru. So you are the guru of all the yogis. And I seek. So that is where, he, with all humility and humbleness, he questions him. That what is the most important duty of one who is about to die? So that is the question that comes to his mind. So now, I would say the hero of the Srimad Bhagavatam is our Parikshit Maharaj, because without his inquiry, without his inquisitiveness, we would not have this great literature being spoken or emanated from the lips of Shukadev Maharaj. So Shukadev, Parikshit Maharaj, in fact, looking at the great exaltedness of Shukadev Goswami, he accepts him as spiritual master, and he requests him to narrate the transcendental glories or pastimes of the Lord. So he was just in a loincloth. He was such a great king. He had so many opulences. He left everything back. And while he's dying, the only thing he's asking is, what is in the best interest of his soul? So Shukadev Goswami is very pleased, and with the submissive and the devotional attitude of the king, and he narrated the nectarian pastimes of the Lord and his various expansions. And that is how the story of Srimad Bhagavatam was, it just like the nectar, it was flown from the lips of Shukadev Goswami. So it is also said that, I just would like to add one point here. So when the question came about what is the most important duty of one who is dying, he explained that, it is the glories of the Lord, one who's glorious pastimes of the Lord, and one should always, meditate and glorify. So these terms, I think we should remember. Hear, meditate, and glorify the Lord always. If we do that, then there will be no janma, mrityu, jara, vyadhi. That is the cycle of birth and death that we go through. So, bhayam, janma, mrityu, bhaya, vyadhi, bhayam, nahi upajayate. So, you will not have that fear at all. And you will face the death with all dignity. So, death will not look like a death anymore to you. So, that was the answer. So I would like to quote a small incident which was quoted by one of the Vaishnavas, that in Padma Purana it is said that while there were all the rishis had assembled in the arena where all the sages had come to meet Parikshit Maharaj, and they were waiting for they were listening from the lips of Shukadev Goswami, demigods also were interested, and they what they said is, we would like to offer divine nectar in exchange to Srimad Bhagavatam. So at that time, Shukadev Goswami said that the divine knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam cannot be traded by the material achievements or your material opulences. You to hell with your the material opulences that you are, or you know, the nectar that you are giving me in exchange. I don't need eternity. I have the eternity of the name of Lord, which is the only thing I need. I don't need the nectar. So that is why, if you see in that assembly, there were no demigods and no devatas present. It's only and only the purified souls, and who were the pure devotees of the Lord. So I would like to quote another instance where about Shuta Goswami. Shuta Goswami is known as one who there's a word which very aptly, in Sanskrit, which aptly defines him, Shrutidhar. So he has that ability where he could hear and word to word repeat it. So he was the one who was present in the assembly of the rishis when the Shukadev Goswami was giving the discourse on Srimad Bhagavatam. And in those days, imagine, now we have CD drives and other storage devices, but this great sage could record every event to the point as it is from Shukadev Goswami. And at the advent of, in the start of Kali Yuga, all the rishis and Brahma rishis and Maharishis, they were already feeling the effect of it. They could see the implications of the Kali Yuga coming in. The Kali Yuga, as you know, it is spanned for 4,32,000 years. So they had to bear it for so much duration. So obviously they were thinking of a solution. How do they mitigate this whole problem of that we are, or the calamity that they are observing as part of Kali Yuga? So what happens? Shuta Goswami says, see, there is only one stop solution. I will tell you that one-stop solution of how you could get away from the repercussions of this Kali Yuga, that is the Srimad Bhagavatam. So he starts narrating Srimad Bhagavatam in the all the rishis in the Naimisharanya. This Aranya is nothing but the Naimisharanya, and people go here for as a holy place, and there's a lot of pilgrimages actually visit this place and take the blessings of the holy dust of Naimisharanyam. So this was the place where, again, I would say the Srimad Bhagavatam was repeated. The rishis had actually planned for 1,000 years yajna, and they were unsure that it would give them the same solution as that of anything else. Even 1,000-year yajna could not pacify bring down the impact of Kali Yuga. So it was only Srimad Bhagavata which was considered to be the panacea or the solution for all problems. So it is that sacred, that divine. Okay, so I will quickly run through now at the holy places around the Srimad Bhagavatam was delivered by Shukadev Goswami. Shukratal is the place. It is known as Shukratal, and Shukadev Goswami speak. And it is almost 5,000 years ago. And it is, in terms of geography, if you see, it is located away between Delhi and Haridwar, and 4 to 5 hours drive and 86 kilometers before you get into Haridwar. And it obviously sits in the banks of Ganga River, and pilgrims visit and recognition because it had such a pivotal role in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And then there is Bhagavat Peeth, where Shukadev Ashram also there. And this tree, I would like to describe a little. So this tree is again in the same place, Shukratal, where it's 5,100-year-old Akshay Vriksha tree, which sits on the top of the hill, where 80,000 sages, imagine 80,000 sages of all ranks gathered to hear Bhagavatam from Shukadeva Maharaj or Shukadev Goswami. it was under the branches of these trees where Shukadeva and King Parikshit sat. So if, I mean, imagine if we take darshan of this holy place, we will be purified. And you can also see a small picture on the right, which it said it is in the shape of Lord Ganesha, if you see, and it is, you know, worshipped by all the devotees. So this is a brief of...
Madhaji, are you sharing any slides, Madhaji? We are seeing only one slide. Is that one, or do you, are you moving the slides?
Oh, I'm already sharing, Prabhuji. I just moved on. Let me reshare the screen.
Otherwise. We are seeing only that what did Shukadeva Goswami. Yeah, now I think you have stopped sharing. Can you reshare again?
Yep, absolutely, Prabhuji. Give me a sec.
Yeah.
Okay, Prabhuji, so which slide were you on? Did you see Shukratal?
Where Shukadeva Goswami was sitting under the tree.
Oh, you were still there. Okay. After Shukadeva.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize. So, Prabhuji, after this slide where, you know, inquiry from the Parikshit Maharaj, we moved on to the demigod story, you know, wherein the demigods were trying to trade the Srimad Bhagavatam in exchange of the Srimad, nectar in exchange of the Srimad Bhagavatam. So this also, there was a slide, if you see.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm
still, and this is.
I'm still not able to see the screen. Vinay Prabhu, are you able to see it?
Let me reshare, Prabhuji.
No problem.
Yeah, that's what actually it was coming, that sharing, but I was not able to see it.
Okay, let me know if it comes this time, Prabhuji. At least when I'm doing a share.
Yeah, it says.
Do you see that?
No, it says Lakshmi has started screen sharing, but I am not seeing yet.
What could be the problem, Prabhuji?
Is it possible to share that in the chat window, Mataji? If possible, I will try to share it. There is an option to, because when you are trying to share, it says Lakshmi has started sharing, but it is not actually appearing.
Okay. Or shall I leave and rejoin? Would that help, or do you want me to?
I don't know, Mataji. Okay, can you try?
Okay, let's not take a risk. Yeah, I will share it in the chat, Prabhuji.
Yeah. And I can share it here, and we will see whether it is coming or not. And. Sorry, Mataji, sorry to stop the flow.
No, Prabhuji. I mean, there's no point, right, if I explain without the right vision. Or can you give me the control? That will be easy, I guess.
Yeah, 1 minute. Yeah. Yeah, it was stuck at here, this location. I'm going to the next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. Yes, with
the ghost. Yeah, this is the Naimisharanya I was talking about.
Yeah.
Okay.
Next one, Mataji.
Okay, sure. So Prabhuji, I don't know if you can you give me the control or?
Let me check whether I can give control. 1 minute.
I don't think I cannot even request.
1 minute. I think I can give control. 1 minute.
I'm requesting, Prabhuji. You should have received the
Request. Now it is coming. Requesting remote control of your screen. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, Mother. Hey,
okay. So
you're able to control, Mataji?
It is a little slow, but no, Prabhuji. I think it's better you only
Shall I move to the next slide, Mataji?
Yes, so Prabhuji, this is the place I was talking about, Shukratal, and then this is the Bhagavad Pitha. Can I go from the point where you actually missed the flow of slides? Just a quick run. I'll not go in detail, but just wherever from the point you lost the visuals.
From here, the last visual, this we stuck up at this visual only for a long time.
Oh, I'm so sorry about it.
No problem, Mother. No problem. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Prabhuji, so this is this shloka I was reciting, and then the beautiful Krishna you can see. I'm sorry that, you know, you could not visualize him at that when I was, reciting it. Anyways, so this is the Krishna's glorification as a most beautiful physical form.
Yeah.
And if you go to the next slide, it's about the little Krishna who delivered Putana in the position of a mother. He liberated her.
Yeah.
So you can go to the next slide. And this is where we spoke about, Srimad Bhagavatam being bitten by the, when the fruit which is bitten by the parrot, it turns so tasteful. In a similar fashion, the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the mature literature from the desire tree of, from the desire tree of Vedic literature, it emanated from the lips of Shukadev Goswami. It turned even more tasteful. So that was the crux of this slide. So yeah, if you can move on. Yeah, this is about was the life story of Parikshit Maharaj, where he garlanded Shamik Muni with the dead snake. Yeah, you can go on. And this is the slide where we spoke about the inquiry of Parikshit Maharaj and his keenness towards attaining the Lord. Next slide, Prabhuji. And this is the slide we spoke about Suta Goswami, Shrutidhar, who actually spoke Srimad Bhagavatam again for the benefit of mankind before the start of Kali Yuga. So this is in Naimisharanya. Next slide, Prabhuji. This is Shukrata. This is the holy place where Shukadev Goswami actually spoke, and people visit this place till even today. So yeah, next slide, Prabhuji. And a quick view of the ashram, the Shukadev ashram here. Next slide, Prabhuji. And then this was a tree I was talking about where you told me that you're not able to see the visuals. So this is the tree which is said to be, 5,100 year old Akshay Vriksha tree, which sits on the top of the hill where 80,000 sages of all ranks gather to hear Shukadev speak on Srimad Bhagavatam 5,000 years ago. And I was talking about the small, Ganesha here. If you see on the branch of the tree, it looks like Lord Ganesha himself. So people come, the devotees come and they perform their puja here at this place, sacred place. So yeah, this is the next slide, Prabhuji. Oh, the slide got kind of, anyways. So Prabhuji, I'm almost, I'm just in the process of concluding, and I wanted to reflect on my learnings from the life story of Shukadev Goswami. So basically Shukadev Goswami teaches us, at least what I have learned, I wanted to just repeat it for everybody's benefit. So see, he was a realized soul. He was already elevated one, he attained liberation even before his birth. But then it is not the ultimate goal of life. If you see, it is just the byproduct of devotional service, and a devotional service is something that must happen eternally. The devotional service to Lord is an endeavor for all time. And liberation is not the ultimate target. That has been my understanding. Please correct me if I'm wrong here, but this is what I felt. And scientific literature like Srimad Bhagavatam cannot be studied by one's own intellectual capacity. So just the way, if there is a medical science, one cannot become a doctor just merely by sitting at home and reading the books on anatomy and physiology. He has to enroll himself into the medical college. He has to go through the proper process and approach and be under the expert guidance of one gurus. In a similar way, this great scientific literature like Srimad Bhagavatam also can be studied and can be, after glorified, and then thereby it can be understood in its right spirit only by the blessings of the spiritual gurus. And the other point I wanted to mention is Parikshit Maharaj, he was in the fag end of his life. He was being haunted by the biggest crisis, but he accepted it with gracefully as the blessing of Krishna. And he was looking for the solution as to how he could invest this time in the best interest of his soul. By singing the transcendental glories and of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So these are the beautiful things that I at least made a note and I learned from the life of the Shukadev Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj. And I mean, it's similar to what I, you know, spoke about the Bhishma Dev last time. He had a boon of Ichchamrityu. Parikshit Maharaj had knew very clearly that when he's going to die. His death was just 7 days from the time he came to know. But he was, I mean, they were focused on the Lord. So that is something we should all learn that and get inspired from these great exalted souls is what I think. So these have been my reflections, Prabhuji. And next slide, if there is any. I don't know if I added that slide. So this slide, Prabhuji, I don't know. I was, I mean, Prabhupada's efforts, I wanted it's worth mentioning here. Because Srimad Bhagavatam, without Prabhupada in this Kali Yuga for our era, otherwise it would have been a remote possibility. Nobody would have read. Today, I am really moved by the devotees of West, of other countries who are listening to Prabhupada's Bhagavatam. So Prabhupada is such great soul. So in fact, if we go to the background little, Prabhupada was instructed by his Guru Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur in sometime around, I think, 1944, that he has to spread the Krishna consciousness in the entire world. So when this was told to him, it was way back, and then at that time he only started, translating Srimad Bhagavatam, and he conceived it to be a humongous task of 60 volumes. Imagine translating 18,000 shlokas of Srimad Bhagavatam. It is he saw that it would take at least 60 volumes, and over the time, he did for almost 5 years he did the translation work, and it was so during that time he could only, I think he could complete three volumes is what I heard. So it took so much of effort for him. Then eventually he travels to US, and in the US he had to spread Krishna consciousness, and not just while he had so many activities in his plate. So at that time, it seems he distributed certain pamphlets, and it is said that the whole philosophy of Krishna consciousness movement is the Srimad Bhagavatam, wherein he mentions that India's message of peace and goodwill. Goodwill and that is how he attracted the people towards Krishna consciousness. So he made so many efforts, and just imagine, it took almost 35 years after Prabhupada left in 1980 for Bhakti Vedanta Trust, book trust, to come up with the complete series of Srimad Bhagavatam. Of course, it was a little sad that Prabhupada could not complete while he was alive, but I'm sure you must have all seen the video where Prabhupada, when he's lying on his deathbed, he's still translating Srimad Bhagavatam. He is not eating, he's not sleeping, he's not drinking, but he is only translating Srimad Bhagavatam. I mean, can people question, right? Like, can such great things happen in this Kali Yuga? We have a living example here. We have someone who was here while we were all there. I mean, it's not some other yuga. It is Kali Yuga. It is in this era when we had such great soul who had shown his extreme devotion to Lord Krishna by translating Srimad Bhagavatam even on the deathbed. So where can he go but Goloka, Prabhuji? So I just wanted to bring this up, and with all this humility, and I would like to give my sincere respects to Prabhupada, and bless that we all are in the Krishna consciousness path, and we get the nectar of Srimad Bhagavatam. We develop that taste for the Lord. We, just the way Shukadeva Goswami, he just not heard the Srimad Bhagavatam, but he experienced it, he assimilated it, he absorbed it, and he glorified it to the mankind. So that kind of a commitment we may not have, but then we can do whatever is in there, our little capacity to do, Prabhuji. So with that note, I would like to conclude. Thank you so much, Prabhuji, for the opportunity.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mataji. For the thoughtful session. Let me stop sharing. Here I go. Couple of, with your permission, Mataji, if I can add a couple of points on top of what you discussed.
Yes, Prabhuji, I'm sure I'm going to make mistakes. So you are always free, Prabhuji. Please go ahead.
A couple of points, Mataji. One is, initially, you have spoken about the history or the background of Shukadev Goswami, where it was a parrot or a parrot associated with the mother Radharani. Prabhuji's and Mataji's, we need to understand that each and every living soul who is currently there in this material world, they would be having a swarupa in the spiritual world. For example, Sukadev Goswami was a living person, like a human who was there, come to give this Srimad Bhagavatam. But his swarupa in the spiritual world is parrot. Like that, each and every soul who is there, once they reach the ultimate abode, either in Vaikuntha planets or Goloka, each and every soul would be having their own swarupa. So they would be getting back their own swarupa. And when we say the swarupa, that swarupa can be a tree, that swarupa can be another Vishnu Duta, and any other entity there. But you know, it is not that if one person having a swarupa of a flower in the spiritual world, if he goes back to spiritual world, that flower would be there, but that flower would be not sad. It will be having a consciousness, pure consciousness. And that flower will not feel that I am a plant, I am not like a Vishnu Duta, it's very bad. No. Actually, the happiness what a Vishnu Duta present in spiritual world would be getting, because their concentration in the spiritual world, each and every entity, whether it's Vishnu Duta or any other living entity occupying its own swarupa in the spiritual world, they will be fully happy and busy serving Krishna. And they are happy in their service. For example, that flower, you are having a swarupa of a flower in the spiritual world. Once you go back to the spiritual world, okay, if Krishna is traveling from there, that flower would be trying to release the wonderful smell of it to Krishna for pleasing him. For the pleasure of the Lord, it will be giving it. Similarly, a tree which is having fruits, that fruit would be craving for somehow going to Krishna and taste himself. So like that, each and every entity has a swarupa in the spiritual world. So once we go back there, there is a possibility that we might attain our original swarupa. But when we attain that original swarupa, it's not like here if we see a tree and a flower. Flower, when we won't value it that much as we value another human being. But there it's not like that. So there is a purpose. Everyone is busy serving it. So serving Krishna. So that's what I was talking about. Swarupa. Swarupa Siddhi. Swarupa Siddhi means we need reaching our own swarupa from where we fell here. So that is something about swarupa. Have you heard of this concept anytime, Prabhuji and Mataji? Swarupa Siddhi? Or is it for the first time you are hearing it?
Prabhuji, I mean, to be very honest with you, after seeing your message, the WhatsApp message, I tried to understand what the Swarupa Siddhi is. Hmm. But, you know, there was a different dimension, I think. I kind of understood that every living being out of many millions of trillions of living beings has the particular relationship with the Lord eternally. So this is called as Swarupa.
Yes.
So by the process of devotional service, one can revive that Swarupa of them. For that stage is called Swarupa Siddhi.
That's right.
Perfection of one's constitutional position. That's so right. Example they have given is Arjuna was a devotee to Lord Krishna as a, I mean, he was devotee, but he was his friend. Hmm. So the Swarupa in which he would glorify or he would treat Krishna as friend. So I mean, I think it is slightly in contrast to what is what I got a sense from your message. So I'm not sure. Maybe I do not know. So the source is again somewhere from our ISKCON. So I don't know whether which one is right. But
yeah. Actually, it's a very advanced topic, Mataji. I mean, just to, since you brought the topic of Shuka. Who was a parrot, Asthana parrot for Radharani. And that's how actually Swarupa is not a topic of discussion or topic for our neophyte devotees like us. It's not a that relevant topic here, because our goal is first to attain the love of God and go break this cycle of birth, death and old age and disease and go back to spiritual world. And this is something topic about once we reach the spiritual world, what kind of sarupa we attain there. I mean, so this anyway, it's not that relevant here, but I just wanted to give a brief about what sarupa means. Okay, so this is not relevant. Okay, that's one thing. That's number one. Next one is Lakshmi Mataji has given, he taken an example of Putana. Putana trying to kill Lord Krishna. Is anyone aware who was Putana in the previous life?
Yeah, I mean, one of the stories that I heard is she was sister of Bali, and somewhere else I heard she was wife of Bali. I'm not sure which one is true, but yeah.
So that the story, Vinay Prabhu and Prasad Prabhu, I hope I'm audible, right?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah. So Putana was the sister of Bali Chakravarti. Okay. She was a sister of Bali Chakravarti. And when Vamana with a short stature has come to the kingdom, at once she thought, after seeing a small dwarf stature of Vamana, she felt it was very lovely, very cute. By seeing the Lord, she felt she got these emotions of liking towards Vamana or our Lord Krishna, and thought how good it had been had I been his mother. So that consciousness she developed at that time, and she wanted to mother himself, or she wanted to be a mother of Lord Krishna by seeing that stature in the previous life. Okay, that is number one part of the story. And the number two part of the story, the same Bali Chakravarti episode is, Putana, when Vamana was occupying the entire worlds with the first two steps, then he asks, where to keep my third step? Then Bali Chakravarti or the Maharaj says to keep the step on his head. And by seeing that scene where he is keeping the head on, Lord Krishna keeping his feet on her brother's head, she got into revenge mode, that I have to kill him. I have to kill him. I need to kill him. I need to take revenge. How come he do it for my brother, to my brother? That's a negative emotion which she developed when she has seen her brother crushed, or seen in that scenario where Lord is trying to put his feet on his head. So those two emotions in a single life, Krishna obliged to satisfy her. Hope I am clear. So that's how she got into this act of trying to kill Krishna in the next life. And with that emotion carrying, he has given a permanent nurse post in Goloka itself. Got it, Prabhuji's and Mataji's? This is the story behind why Putana came into the picture and why Putana tried to kill Krishna. And even before killing Krishna, she had for a moment, what a beautiful child. She got that emotion of mother, which was carrying from her past life. Okay, that was the little bit elaboration what I wanted to give on top of what Lakshmi Mataji has said. Am I clear, Mataji?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah. And third point, Mataji, from your session, I don't know whether I missed it or not, Mataji, but you told like Shukadev Goswami has come back to his father and along with other disciples, and he heard Bhagavatam from his father Vedavyas himself. But I don't know whether you covered this point or not, Mataji. When
I covered that, Prabhuji, there are four sources from which he heard Bhagavatam.
Some, I don't know if I missed it or not, but I think that particular point that he, when he was in womb itself, he heard the Srimad Bhagavatam.
Lord Shiva. Yeah, I mean, one is Lord Shiva, Agastya Mahamuni, and then Vedavyasa, and then Narad Mahamuni, and Devada Rishi also, I heard.
Right. That's the point. Probably I missed it. So if it is covered, well and good, Mataji. Next, fourth one is, Mataji, you told Parikshit Maharaj is one of the Mahajan, right, Mataji?
Yes, I think that's a mistake, Prabhuji, correct? Yeah.
Parikshit Maharaj is not one among the 12 Mahajans, Mataji, just for information, okay?
Yes.
He is surely a devotee of Lord, Mataji, but it doesn't mean that there are so many devotees in the past, there are so many exalted devotees like Dhruva Maharaj. Dhruva Maharaj is also devotee, but he's not considered as
Mahajan
category. But there's no undermining that Dhruva Maharaj, since he's not part of Mahajan, he's not considered to be as a devotee. We should not consider, or we should not think in that manner. Okay.
Actually, Prabhuji, I wanted to add that in the Naimisharanya, Yama, actually, I mean, whenever Srivad Bhagavatam is spoken, Yama also, Yamaraj also comes and listens.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, in the flow, I somehow, you know, in quoted that Mahajan as Parikshit Maharaj instead of Yamaraj.
Yeah,
I agree that. I actually immediately wanted to correct it. I forgot. Thank you for the...
No problem, Mataji. Actually, Yamaraj, you know, being in that position, there is a scarcity of devotees. He really longing for devotee association. So he's fed up there. So whenever any leela or any pastime happens with any devotee, he wanted to be part of it somehow.
Yes, and in fact, they say that whoever is listening to Srimad Bhagavatam, or you know, whoever is reading it, they will obviously, because Yamaraj is sitting next to them, he will not, they can be rest assured that he will not take away their life.
Yeah.
So, that's what he said.
Yes, Mataji. So, yeah, so that's one point. Parikshit Maharaj is not a margin. And fifth point was, Mataji, Srimad Bhagavatam or any scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, as you rightly mentioned, Mataji, it has to be learned under the expert advice or expert supervision of Guru and Parampara. There are, Mataji and Prabhuji, actually, there are a lot of people around in our community, or in this world, where they might be having PhDs, they might be materialistically, they might be having a wonderful degrees with them, and they might be in impression. They have read, I personally have seen so many people saying that I read the Bhagavad Gita completely. They might have only read it, but they might not know, they might not know the essence of Bhagavad Gita, because the scriptures are of that nature only. That, I mean, the scriptures are the only type of, I don't know, books where only with Pariprashnena Sevaya, Pariprashne, only under the supervision of Guru, by doing some service to Guru, then only you can understand. Even you might be reading pages and pages and pages, but you would not be in a situation to understand the essence of it. You might be in an impression. Psychologically, you might be satisfied. I read it. Yeah, you'll be reading it. What is the reading? It will be done. Because in my school days, one small example, okay. I used to read this history books. So whenever madam, my class teacher, my history madam, Gupta madam. So Gupta madam, she attends the class, I used to be loving to be called myself and asking, Mahesh, you read. So she used to call me because I used to, without any break, I used to read it without any breaks or any word is there. No break used to be there. I didn't used to give any break and continuously I used to read. So always madam used to tell me, most of the time she used to tell me, Mahesh, you read. And I used to love it that she's asking me to read. But I only used to read. But never, I never was concentrating on getting what I'm reading. And in, you know, you don't believe, in social studies, in 10th class, I just, I mean, that is a pathetic story. In 10th class, I am the lowest marked guys, like just pass. I got out of 100, 35 is the pass mark. I just got 36 in social studies and I was a class topper in mathematics. So teachers didn't know how to react to me. I was a class topper in mathematics and in social studies, I just got passed. So I just gave this example to just to quote saying that reading only doesn't matter. Only the understanding stuff happens only when you are under the supervision of a guru, or you are pariprashnian is when you are doing service to guru, and with that service and with that inquiry, only you can attain this knowledge from guru. You might read, you might be an impression, psychologically you might be satisfied. I read Srimad Bhagavatam, I read Bhagavad Gita, but essence to understand, you need to be under parampara, you need to understand that from the guru, and you need to do service. Pariprashnena sevaya. Only by doing seva, they can give multiple versions of multiple, their own view, like how we need to understand each and every sloka. So that is the importance of this scriptures. Scriptures especially, we have to understand under the supervision of Guru, not like our material books. That is the example what I wanted to take from my own life. I mean, I used to read, when I used to love, okay, when I used to read how people are seeing me, oh, madam always calling me. I used to enjoy a lot, madam is always calling me. But I never, I didn't pay attention to understand what I'm reading, but I was reading and I was internally getting satisfied that yes, madam is calling me, madam is having a good impression on me. That is wrong. So like that in our real society, in our current society also, there are so many people, there are so many materialistically, there are very, middle qualification wise, they are very good. There are so many PhD holders who say that I read Bhagavad Gita completely. But when we see the lifestyle of them, they are not at all matching with the scriptures what they are reading. So Prabhuji and Mataji, whatever Lakshmi Mataji has said, like these scriptures, we need to understand only in the guidance of a guru and parampara and from the exalted devotees of the Lord. So we need to take that point seriously. Next, last point of Mataji. So you told about Parikshit Maharaj and you know, whatever the story Mataji told about Parikshit Maharaj, that is true. 5,100 years back, which has happened. And when Sringi has cursed him that he has to die in 7 days time by Takshaka flying bird, snake, Takshaka snake, he would be killed or died after it bits. Okay, so that was the curse what he has given. But Parikshit Maharaj had an eligibility, or Parikshit Maharaj had a chance to even reverse the curse. It was there in his hands. It was there in his hands. He can reverse it, but he never reversed it. He has taken that into his stride and accepted the truth. How many are there within us who can accept the truth? Generally, it is very common when we get a good success, especially I'm talking about devotees themselves, when we get some material success, say I got promotion, or I got certification completed, or I got a recognition or a bonus or something. We say that with Lord Krishna's mercy, I got thing. We say that with Lord Krishna's mercy, I got certified. With Lord Krishna's mercy, I got promotion. With Lord Krishna's mercy, I got a good family. I got good children. We say that. But when something negative happens, are we ready to take that into our stride? Like I failed. Probably it is Krishna's will. I didn't get promoted. And even next year also, I didn't get promoted. Are we in a position to take it in our stride? I don't have good children. I don't have a good wife. Are we in a position to take it in our stride? I have lost my husband. I have lost my wife. I have my child died. My Prabhuji died. Are we in a position to take that into our stride? So these are the things Matajis and Prabhujis where, you know, we need to understand that it is not a place of happiness. Ashashvatam Dukkhalayam. There are some devotees, you know, even in our congregation where they understand the philosophy and they are attracted to the philosophy, what our Guru Parampara is saying, but some are not in ready to accept the situation that they say, ఏంటండి అశాశ్వతం దుఃఖాలయం అంటారు, ఏం పెద్ద నొప్పులు ఉన్నాయని, ఏం పెద్ద పెయిన్ ఉందని, ఇక్కడ నాకు కుదిరినప్పుడు నేను సినిమాలు చూసుకుంటున్నాను, నాకు మంచి హస్బెండ్ ఉన్నాడు, నాకు మన ఫ్యామిలీ పరంగా డబ్బుకు దోకా లేదు, దగ్గర వెళ్ళి లక్షల లక్షలు మంత్లీ మనకు శాలరీ వస్తుంది, రెండు మూడు ఇళ్ళులు ఉన్నాయి, పాప ఒక బాబు పాప ఉన్నారు, they are really studying very good and they are intelligent and they are class toppers also, em kashtalu unnai manaki ani anukune vallu kuda unnaru. But we need to understand Prabhuji and Mataji, when asalaina testing anedi manaki, you know, when we face with this negative items and still we are not leaving Krishna, that's the point of testing Prabhuji and Mataji, where appudu and manaku manchi jariginappudu aa krishnudu devala jarigindi, manchi deyam jarigindi krishnudu devala jarigindi ani cheptuntam manam, kaani ade idi krishna will ani ade positivity tho manam munduku vellagalama without leaving. There are so many devotees when something negative happens, it's very traumatic experience to them, and they even whatever bhakti lata bhakti ante manlanti neophyte devotees Prabhuji and Mataji, generally ee statement anedi chaala applicable anamata. Bhakti lata is very subtle, chaala sanna teega manaku te lata ante telusu kada, lata is a very small teega, manam koncham idi aina manaku adi crush ayye chance untadi. So we need to be, మనం ఆ లతాని అంటే మనం ఎలా అయితే ఒక క్రీప్ అదే మనకు చెట్టు చిన్న చెట్టు లతాని కాపాడుకోవడానికి మనం ఏం చేస్తాం, చుట్టూరితో ఏదో పెట్టడము, లేకపోతే గాలి వాన వస్తాయంటే జాగ్రత్త పెట్టడము. సో దాని తగ్గట్టు అసోసియేషన్ వారిని దాని తగ్గట్టు మనం ప్రొటెక్ట్ చేసుకొని ట్రై చేస్తాం. అందుకని అలా అదే విధంగా మనకు మన ఎనీవే వాట్ ఆర్ ద న్యూ ఫైట్ డివోటీస్ ఆర్ జస్ట్ వీఆర్ సాధకా జస్ట్ వీ ట్రైంగ్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ భక్తి అండ్ ఆల్, వీ నీడ్ టు ensure that what keeps our bhakti very safe, are ee worldly people tho enta interaction unte mana bhakti anedi anta back seat teeskune avakasam untadi. So we need to ensure that we are more associated with the devotees or with the lord or in any form deity worship or in his service. So aa rakamga we can save our bhakti lata, mana bhakti anedi oka lata lantidi. So when we are more associating with the worldly people, meelo ikkada unna vallu evaraina madapattina yenugunu chusara Prabhuji and Mataji live ga, has someone seen a wild elephant rampaging like anything live? Evaraina chusara? Prasad Prabhu, Vinay Prabhu, Krishna Mataji chudaleda?
Ledu Prabhu,
ledu Prasad Prabhu. ప్రసాద్ బాబు చూసారా? చూడలేదు. మద పెట్టిన ఏనుగు అని గూగుల్ చేయండి, వైల్డ్ ఎలిఫెంట్ గ్రాంపేజింగ్ అని గూగుల్ చేయండి. మనం అంటే ఈ మెటీరియల్ అసోసియేషన్తో ఎలా ఉంటుందంటే, మనం మనకున్న భక్తి లత అనేది ఎంత ఎక్కువ మనం మన మెటీరియలిస్టిక్ పీపుల్తో అసోసియేట్ అయితే మన భక్తి చాలా సన్నగా ఉన్న భక్తి లత అంత దారుణంగా క్రష్ అయ్యే అవకాశం ఉంది. క్రష్ అయ్యే అవకాశం ఉంటుంది. ఎందుకంటే ఈ మాయావాదీస్ కానివ్వండి, దే ఆర్ వెరీ కన్విన్సింగ్. అంటే మనకు వాళ్ళు అనర్గళ జ్ఞానయోగంలో చాలా ఇదిగా ఉంటారు, చాలా శ్లోకాలు, చాలా మంత్రోచ్చారణ కానివ్వండి, లేకపోతే వరల్డ్లీ అసోసియేషన్, ఏం తప్పు ఉంది, ఏముంది, ఏం లేదు, యు ఆర్ అన్నెసరీ అన్న మనం కన్విన్స్ కూడా అయిపోతాం. సో వీ షుడ్ బి వెరీ కేర్ఫుల్ ప్రభుజీసన్ మాతాజీ, మన భక్తి లతాని మనం కాపాడుకోవాలి. ఓకే, సో దిస్ వాజ్ స్మాల్ పాయింట్, కృష్ణాస్ బ్లెస్సింగ్ ఓన్లీ విన్, అదే ఈ పాయింట్ కూడా కన్వే చేద్దాం అనుకున్నాను. వాట్ మన లక్ష్మీ మాతాజీ చెప్పినప్పుడు మాతా ప్రభుజీ చెప్పండి.
వైల్డ్ ఎలిఫెంట్ ఏంటి? వైల్డ్ ఎలిఫెంట్ గూగుల్ చేయమన్నారు కదా మీరు, వైల్డ్ ఎలిఫెంట్ అంటే చాలా
లేదు బ్రో. నేనేం చెప్పానంటే వైల్డ్ ఎలిఫెంట్ కానీ లేకపోతే పిచ్చి పట్టిన ఏనుగుకి కానీ మనం ఒక 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 సమాజంలో వదిలేసాం అనుకోండి, అది ఎలా బిహేవ్. మీరు బాహుబలి చూసుంటారు, బాహుబలి చూస్తారు కదా, అందులో మొదటి సీన్లో ఏనుగుకు ఏదో మరి ఐ డోంట్ నో వాట్ హ్యాపెన్స్ బట్ పిచ్చి పెట్టినట్టు అది వెళ్తుంది కదా, అది ఎవరు ఎవరున్నారే ఎవరున్నారే అని చూసుకోదు. అది తెలుగులో ఏమంటారు దాన్ని, క్రష్ని ఏమంటారు నాకు గుర్తు రావట్లేదు, ఎవరి మీద పడితే ఇంకా పచ్చడి పచ్చడి అయిపోతారు. సో ఆ పిచ్చిలో దానికి తెలియదు ఎవరు ఎవరిని తొక్కుతున్నాను, ఏమి తొక్కుతున్నాను అని అర్థం కాదు. సో మనము మెటీరియలిస్టిక్ పర్సన్ ఒక భౌతిక ప్రపంచంలో ఉన్న వాళ్ళతో ఎక్కువ కాంటాక్ట్ పెట్టుకోవటం వల్ల మనకున్న సన్నటి భక్తిలత అనేది ఆ పిచ్చి పట్టిన ఏనుగుకి ముందు వెళ్తున్న దానితో సమానం అన్నమాట. దట్స్ ద పాయింట్ వాట్ ఐ వాంటెడ్ టు ట్రై టు కమ్యూనికేట్ ప్రభు. అర్థమైందా ప్రభు? ప్రభుజీ దట్స్ వాజ్ జస్ట్ ఒక ఉదాహరణ తీసుకున్నాను నేను. అంటే ఎలాగంటే మన భక్తిలత అనేది చాలా సన్నగా ఉంది, సో మనం ఎక్కువ ఇలా భౌతిక ప్రపంచంతో ఉన్న వాళ్ళతో మనం ఎక్కువ అసోసియేట్ అయితే గిన మన భక్తిలత అనేది పచ్చడి పచ్చడి అయ్యే అవకాశం, అంటే మద పట్టిన ఏనుగు ముందు పెట్టినట్టు లెక్క అన్నమాట. సో అది చెప్పడానికే ఈ అడవి ఏనుగు లేకపోతే పిచ్చి పట్టిన ఏనుగు ఎగ్జాంపుల్ తీసుకోవడం జరిగింది. అర్థమైందా ప్రభు? యా సో దట్స్ ద పాయింట్ ప్రభు. సో దీస్ ఆర్ ద ఓన్లీ అడిషన్స్ ప్రభు ఆన్ టాప్ ఆఫ్ వాట్ లక్ష్మీ మాతాజీ వాజ్ సేయింగ్. ఐ వాంటెడ్ టు స్టాప్ రికార్డింగ్ హియర్.